Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you. I'm Pastor Ken and my wife, Joan. It's so nice to see that crowds growing each Sunday and just be able to worship. We have a great service today. You can tell by the opening slide. It's a pretty special service. And good news, it's 18 degrees, which means your skin will only freeze in 20 minutes rather than 5. But the good news is, it's going to be 20s and 30s this week. Isn't that great? So hopefully we can get out and about as well. So welcome everyone. So happy that you're here as we continue with our fifth Sunday after Epiphany as we gather. Fields are white and the harvest waiting. Who will bear the sheaves away? Who will answer gladly saying, "Here am I, send me, send me"? Our human nature urges us to not volunteer so quickly or so gladly. The prophet Isaiah was reluctant. It was only when his sins were forgiven that he was moved to respond, "Here am I, send me." And Peter, too, was reluctant. After seeing the great catch of fish, he fell at Jesus' feet and said, "Go away from me, for I am a sinful man." Yet Jesus called him to fish for people. Our sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus, and God puts the same question to all of us this morning. Will you go and work? And may we joyfully answer, "Here am I, send me. Here I am, send me."
Thank you.
hearing God's voice calling us. I love the idea that we're holding God's people around us in our hands together as well. Praise God. We'll continue and we'll do our invocation, and then we're going to read responsively the great Isaiah's call, Isaiah 6. I begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Old Testament reading, Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." Here ends the Old Testament reading. Thanks be to God. Our confession and absolution. Woe is me, for I am lost.
I am a person of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips.
Let us confess our sins to God our Father together. Lord God, we have sinned against you with our lips, with our minds, with our hands, and with our attitudes. We have done the things you forbid, and have turned away from doing those things you honor. Too often I have not responded to your call to serve you, but instead have chosen to serve myself. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, so I can joyfully say, "Here I am, send me." God has heard our sincere confession and has touched us with the power of his love. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I have the privilege to announce to you that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Savior, King of grace.
Schönste Herr Jesu. Yeah, it's beautiful. So we continue with the gospel. Jesus knows how to call his disciples. Notice that he gets in Peter's boat, and he has Peter in the boat with him, and he pushes him off, and he does his whole sermon to the people on the shore, and then he asks them to go out again, even though they're really tired. Luke chapter 5. And Lake Gennesaret is the same lake as Sea of Galilee, which isn't a sea, it's a lake. It's 8 miles wide and 14 miles long, Sea of Galilee. One day, as Jesus was standing by the Lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and he asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night. We haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. So were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. This is the gospel of our Lord. Let's ask the Spirit to help us with that. Lord God, thank you so much. We can hear your voice calling in the night. Sometimes we don't want to hear it, but we really do. So thank you for calling each one of us from our baptisms all the way through our life. Your calling is a lifelong calling to each one of us. And the reason we're all still alive simply is because you're still calling us. And thank you, Lord, that we can still be serving you. In your name we pray. Amen. I saw this slide. I love this slide. And I thought, the first time this morning I was looking at it again, and I saw this ring on their thumb. I thought, it's kind of strange, isn't it? Put a ring on your thumb. It's like a man's hands. And I thought, you know what? This is the prodigal son. You know, he's sleeping with the pigs, he wakes up, he goes, I'm not worthy, Father, to become, even, I want to be your servant, I'm not worthy to be your son, and he puts a ring on his finger, kills the calf, you know, a robe, the finest robe. Your brother was dead, he's alive again. He's willing to serve, because he knows what it was like being dead. And so, we have this amazing story today. We have two stories. And a lot of callings by the different prophets and disciples. And the first one, I like this. It says, worship demands an awareness of the majesty of God. And I've said this before, but I forget that the angels are with me, protecting me. I forget the angels are here. You know, I can hear, I can feel the brush of an angel's wing. I see glory on each face. You know, I forget that oftentimes. But God reminds me through you. He reminds me of these special encounters. Angels unawares as well. And so Isaiah, what does it say? In the year, this is nice because we know for sure that King Uzziah, it's documented, died in 739 BC before Christ. And that's when Isaiah got the call. So we know how long it was before Christ came. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up. And the train of his robe filled the temple. And above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face. With two he covered his feet. And with two he flew. Can you imagine being an artist and trying to paint something like this? I found a couple pictures. Here's the first one. There's Isaiah on the far left there. He's a man of unclean lips. You know, we can relate. And all of a sudden, God wants to call Isaiah because he is such a powerful, as you know, his book is so amazing, so prophetic as well. And so here comes a seraph. Seraph, or these bright, shining seraph, means fire, means light. And so they came, and their faces are covered, they got wings, their feet are covered. And here's another artist's rendition. This is interesting. It's a little more subtle, but it's beautiful. Did you notice there's Isaiah in the bottom left, and there's the tongs coming down from the altar to touch his lips. And then it says, and they were calling to one another, these angels were calling back and forth, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. There's only two times in the whole Bible that the words holy, holy, holy are ever used. And when Jesus repeats the word, truly, truly, I say to you, it means this is really important. And when it's repeated three times, it means it's the purest essence, it's the purest light, it's the purest presence of God there is. Holy, holy, holy. Do you remember when the other one was? I bet some of you know in the New Testament. Holy, holy, holy. Anyone? Revelation, exactly. So here's John. He's the last living disciple. He's about 100 years old. He has been exiled on the Greek island of Patmos, and while he's there, he begins Revelation, first chapter. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. And then as he's looking up, God sends his angel with a revelation to give to John. And John looks up in the sky, and he sees this vision. And he sees these four living creatures, and it says, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, just like our altar here, you know, the presence of God and the Good Shepherd and everything else. And notice there's threes here so much. There's holy, holy, holy. There's Lord God Almighty. who is, who was to come, right? Our Lord and God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power, all these threes, the perfect number, right, in Christ as well. Because of your will, they exist and were created, and he looks and he sees these four living creatures. I just love this slide. There's the Lion of Judah, there's a man with a son, and there's the eagle represented by John, and there's the ox, which is represented by Luke, I believe it is. Do you remember there was one other person? This isn't a Bible quiz this morning, but there's one other person who had a vision of the Old Testament of four living creatures in the very first chapter. Anyone remember who that was? Ezekiel. And I know you know, so many of you know that. Just read Ezekiel chapter 1 sometime this week. Oh my gosh. And then go into chapter 2. It's so powerful. And Ezekiel sees this wheel and the wheel and this vision. And he sees these four living creatures, right? And he's there. But we go back to Isaiah. So the foundation is the threshold. You can't even see God. All you can see, he's so mighty and powerful and awesome. You can only see the train of his robe, which fills the temple. And as they call out, the temple is filled with smoke, right? And what is Isaiah's response? What would our response be? It would be like John on Patmos, if you remember, when the angel first came, he fell down to worship the angel. And the angel said, don't do that. I'm your servant. You know, I'm here to serve. And then so the response is, woe to me, I cry. I am ruined. I love that word. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips. I live among people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Almighty. And then it says, as we read, then one of the seraphim flew to me, burning coal. He took it from the other. The angel can't even hold this. It's so intense. So he has his tongs, and he takes it and touches his mouth. And what does he say? I kind of like our reading in our lesson today a little bit better than this translation. This one says, behold, this has touched your lips, and your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is forgiven. But in our lesson, the other version, NIV, says, your guilt has been taken away and your sins are forgiven. A lot of times we can believe Jesus forgives our sins, but we hang on to our guilt, don't we? We allow our guilt to paralyze us. And so God is saying, like King David, created me a clean heart, and God took away David's sin and his guilt, you know, it says. And so God does that. A couple pictures. Here's one, Isaiah calling. Tongs, the coal. Here's a beautiful stained glass. It's not overly dramatic, perhaps, but it'd be beautiful to have this in your church or in your home, wouldn't it? Six-winged seraph there with the coal. But this is my favorite one. Like this one. Takes the coal, touches his lips, and he's cleansed. And then God says, so, I heard the voice of God saying, who will go? Who should I send? Who will go for us? And he said, is that kind of great? It's kind of almost reverse psychology. God goes, I wonder who I can send and who will go for us. And Isaiah is jumping up and down. You know, here I am as well. And then we go to Peter. You got to love it. Jesus in Peter's boat, right? Go out. But I'll do it, Lord, even though I'm so tired, I'm falling asleep as I'm cleaning my nets. But as I listen to you in my boat, sharing these words of life and hope, I am stirred in my heart. Like the thief on the cross, the murderer, Father, forgive them. He comes to believe from Christ's words. And Peter says, I'll do that. And he lets down the net. And can you believe it? There's at least two great catch of fish in the Bible. One is at the end of John. Remember, it said there were 153 large fish, and Peter went and dragged them ashore. That's a lot different than this one. There's a lot more than 153 here. It filled both boats. Can you believe it? These were big boats. There's a boat in Israel when you go by Capernaum. There's a boat they found when the drought, the waters went low. It's called the Jesus boat. Some of you have seen it. And it was from the first century. It's a boat just like they used, where Jesus could have fallen asleep in the back of the boat. It's huge, it's wide. And lots of people, like a Viking almost. It's not real big, but you know, 10, 12 people could fit in one, or maybe 6 to 8. Anyway, these are filled and they're sinking. I mean, boats don't sink, you know, but they're sinking with these fish, and Peter's like, you gotta love Peter, don't you? He's brash, you know, he's afraid sometimes, but he has such a good heart, doesn't he? And he just falls at Jesus' feet and says, I'm just not worthy, Lord. And Jesus said, don't worry about it, Peter. You're gonna catch people now as well. So I thought about all the people that got called in the Bible, and I didn't list all of them because there's so many, but just a few here. God calls Abraham. He's in modern-day southern Iraq, which was the Ur of the Chaldees, Mesopotamia. And God, he's worshiping the moon god, believe it or not. His father is Terah. This is Genesis 12, you can read it for yourself. And in Hebrews, it cross-references. God calls, how old is Abraham about then? Well, he's in his mid-90s. Because a few years later, he's 100 and Sarah's 90 and they have Isaac. And then a few years later, they march up the hill and Isaac has the wood on his back, right? For the sacrifice. He's your age and older. How about this? They kind of put Moses kind of young here. But how old, again, I'm asking a lot of questions today. This is a rhetorical question. You know how old Moses was when he's in the wilderness watching his sheep and he sees the burning bush? He's 80 years old. He's 40 years in Pharaoh's court. He's 40 years as a shepherd. Here comes the burning bush and God says, you're going to go? He goes, I can't even talk very well. I got like a speech thing. He goes, well, your brother Aaron, he's great. He's a great speaker. I'll give you Aaron. You know, and he's making all these excuses. But so for another 40 years, he's in the wilderness with a stiff-necked, rebellious people. Finally, he makes it to top of Mount Nebo, right? He's 120. He's still alive and kicking, but God takes him. God buries him. He can't go in, but Joshua and Caleb. And everyone who's been born since in the last 40 years are the ones that go into the promised land. Speaking of reluctant prophets, we all know about Jonah. Nineveh is that way, Jonah. Why are you going that way? Don't you love that? The call of God. And Nineveh, and he went that way because he knew who God was, and he knew that God was merciful, and he knew that God would even forgive their enemies if they repented in sackcloth and ashes. And they did. You know, so he didn't want to be there when that happened. Jeremiah. He was a reluctant prophet. Again, chapter 1 of Jeremiah, if you have time this week, you know, read chapter 1 of Ezekiel, chapter 1 of Jeremiah. God says to Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb, Jeremiah, I knew you. And he says, I'm calling you. And Jeremiah goes, I can't do this. All these excuses. And what does God say? Jeremiah, you don't have to say anything. I'll give you all the words to say. I'll put my words in your mouth. You just say to the people what I give you. He was the weeping prophet. It's very difficult. He was killed for his faith later, but he was faithful. But how about a young child? You know, how about Samuel? This is an older child, but remember Samuel? Just a young boy, right? He's just in the temple, and he hears the voice. He thinks it's Eli, but it's not. His great mother, Hannah, you know, barren, had him, gave him to the Lord. And he said, here I am. Here I am. Whoops, I'm sorry. That happens sometimes. Sorry. I hit the wrong button and I go back home. Back home is the very first slide. Thank you. There you go. So finally, we get the New Testament. Here comes Jesus. This is Caravaggio. And here's Matthew counting his money. He doesn't want to be pointed at, but everyone's pointing him. That's him. That's Matthew. And Jesus calls Matthew, and he counts and follows him. Chief tax collector and sinner, right, comes to him as well. And then, of course, it's one of those days, you guys. Thank you for bearing with me. We're almost there. Oops, can't see the head too much. God calls Paul, right? Paul has a vision, and we're going to Damascus. He says in 2 Corinthians 12, he has a vision of heaven. You can read it for yourself. And finally, to us, got a cell phone? God is calling us. God is calling you. And you go, well, I'm not so sure. Maybe hit the left button. Remind me later, maybe. Maybe decline. Or hit the green button. Accept it. And what does that mean? It means that God is not calling us to work for him. He's calling us to walk with him, right? Also, as far as the church, God is not calling us to go to church. He's calling us to be his church, the hope of the world. Obviously, he's calling us to worship. Remember the Sabbath day, right? But we're calling to be the church. And we heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Who will go?" I like this one, but I like this one even better. This is like someone that I might not be a friend with. I mean, I could welcome them as a friend, but a little hoodie on there, and it reminds me that God is using absolutely everyone to reach out to everyone else, right? And us. And if you don't have a cell phone that looks like that, God calling, I'm sure some of you remember this one, right? Yeah, so God is calling this party line there, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You know, the Spirit is interceding, getting our calls through as well. And then, last couple slides here. This is powerful. This is 2 Timothy. God never calls us, I know you guys know this, but I forget this. God never calls us to do anything without giving us the power to do it, giving us the gifts to do it, giving us the grace to do it. He saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. In other words, God is calling you, he's equipping you, he's preparing you according to his purpose. And if you're saying, you know, I can't preach like Paul, I can't speak like angels, there's a lot we can do, isn't there? We want to close this last part of the song we just sang and kind of take it to heart a little bit more as we sing. So thank you, Lord, for equipping us this morning, for encouraging us, for empowering us, for maybe giving us new insights on how to reach out with the love of Christ to others. And Lord, we just include all of our prayers. There's so many today. We want to thank you for the warm weather. You know, we want to pray for those who are in recovery, who are here this morning, who've had surgery, who are in rehab. We want to thank you for miracles present today, people who should have died, but they're here, Lord, and you brought them back. And Lord, too, for our loved ones. A year ago tomorrow, my mother passed away. And each one of us has losses, but I just praise you for their faith. I praise you for I am who I am because of my mother, my mother-in-law, my father-in-law, and so many other ways today that you give us families to encourage us. Lord, there's so many prayers, there's birthdays and anniversaries and celebrations. We give them all to you. We pray for our leaders, we pray for our churches. We pray for those who would be godly and reach out with the love of Christ. So Lord, continue to empower each one of us. Teach us what you have us learn, and then give us the joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. In Jesus' name we pray all these things, believing. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And Moses' beautiful brother Aaron gave us the benediction. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon each one of us and give us his peace. Amen.
You are the one we adore. You